Hello, welcome back to Campaign Coins, playing BEOWULF Age of Heroes, the Hero Sanctuary. Oh, we just lost Mark, let me bring him back. This is does not bode well for our our hopefully thrilling conclusion, but here we are, we're back again, playing BEOWULF Age of Heroes.
I'm going to say I'm psyching you out, and that was not my crushing technical ineptitude.
Of course, that's a good story. I am Jackson from Campaign Coins, and this is Mark from Campaign Coins, and we are Campaign Coins, and BEOWULF Age of Heroes is a fantastic setting slash rules variation for 5th edition of your favorite role-playing game. It's all about duet play. That's why there's one Gamemaster and there's one player in the tradition of the Epic of Beowulf. We're playing the Hermit's Sanctuary, rather, which is a free download from Handiwork Games and on Drive-Thru RPG. And it is the introductory adventure that we've been playing and having a great time with, following the adventures of Bold Eadig as he hunts down a monster on this island of Sanctuary. We are... There it is. Also here, listening to... we were listening to it, but we seem to have lost it. Let me see if I can bring them back. We are listening to some lovely sounds made by Sirenscape, which is a fantastic online tool you can use to pump all sorts of rad... sounds and soundscapes and music into your role-playing games. Really adds an extra layer of immersion, and we dig it, and I've just broken it. Technical difficulties plague us today, but I'm sure I'll bring that back very soon.
While Jackson stares at Sirenscape, want to shout out to Handiwork Games, as Jackson already has, in particular John Hodgson, creative director and one of the authors of Beowulf, along with his co-conspirator Jacob Rogers. You can get the PDF on Drive-Thru for $20, and just as pure inspiration for the exciting bones of narrative and a whole new way to think about any campaign, I think it is a fantastic read. It's cracking with ideas. So whether you use the setting or not, big up, we're playing it because we love it. Is that the ocean I can hear, Jackson?
It is. It's a stony beach with busy gulls overhead. Beautiful.
Don't want any of those lazy gulls.
No, that's right. All right. I think we're good to start.
Listen. In those days, there was darkness in the forest and beyond. People would gather in small communities in their mead halls. They would lock the doors and stoke the fires and tell stories to pass the night to raise their courage. But sometimes the stories were terrible. The stories were of monsters. And sometimes, like the fiend Grendel, a monster would come to the mead hall and begin to kill. Grendel slew 30 of the Geats before the hero Beowulf came for him. And thus any who are plagued by monsters hope for a hero. A hero like Bald Eadig on the Hermit Sanctuary. He crossed the whale road because he had heard from a Danish merchant that people were being slain, reduced to bloody bones. And now he has found the lair of the monster. He and his five followers stand atop the cliffs. They are, of course, Leofgud, his seasoned warrior, Eastmund, strong, but more a follower of followers rather than a leader of followers. Thormund, the man who has ambition to be a hero. Saewyn, the woman who knows that fighting leads to death and she quietly makes her own fortune. And they are missing Nut the Old, for he was slain by the monster, but joined by the boy Edgar, who has led them to the top of this cliff, which we can see now, with the gulls circling overhead. Another fantastic painting by John Hodgson. And you have reached the top of the cliff and look down to a very rocky, desolate, slimy section of beach on the western shore. And down there, as you crane your heads over, you can see the dark opening of a cave. And among the rocks, you can see a smashed small boat, a coracle, the boat of the monk who came here for his salvation of his soul And instead, he found the jaws of the fiend, his life bud scattered on the island. The boat has been smashed, not by the waves, but by the powerful monster. And I believe the traitor Eadig is also here with you, looking down, saying, that is the boat. That is it. And Edgar, eager to impress, eager having just joined. I knew I could take you here. I will show the way down. And nimbly, with the gulls circling overhead, even though 1 foot wrong and the boy will be dashed to death on the rocks below, and you, Bald Eadig, will have to face his mother. And if you think the monster is terrible, oh boy, I got news for you. So you're beginning to climb. All right.
Excellent.
So are you going to let the boy, as he has said, lead the way, or are you going to say, no, this is my job?
No, I've heard it told that he's a good climber, and he has indeed grown up on this island and knows it inside out. I think he's the best guide that we have to show us the safe way down the cliff.
All right. He is going forwards and he's about to start climbing. And Saywin is looking, giving Eadig the stink eye. And you've seen the Saywin stink eye. It is very uncomfortable. She used it to make Foreman the Berserk back down. And she is giving him the stink eye right now.
All right. Elfnoff, you stay where we can see you. You're going down with us too.
He looks like quite the climber, quite the athlete. I'm sure he'll be good at climbing. Why doesn't he go first? Seeing as he's climbed down and up once before. And as Saywin is saying that, you're looking at Elfnoff, who sweat is now pouring off him. There's no way that weedy traitor climbed up and down this cliff. That is absolutely not possible. Meanwhile, Edgar is making a death saving throw with advantage as he nimbly starts to shimmy his way down the cliff.
He needs a death saving throw to not die on the cliff?
Well, wow. I gave you advantage, unless you want to stop him right now.
No, I thought we were all going down as a group and we're going to follow him tightly. So that he can show us all the right way, but if he needs a saving throw, he needs a saving throw. He will with a 19 and a 17.
That was none. But I have something to tell you if we can check out, of course, remind ourselves over here of the inspiration pool, which the rubber has hit the road. Well, I'm sure this inspiration will be spent today. I still have monster inspiration because baleful grief was your portent. I have used the grief with the death of Nut the Old, with the unkindest disadvantage saving throw of all. You still have a hero saving throw and you still have a follower saving throw.
I do.
But I'd just like to say, Q Workshop, my weapon of choice, love them. I've been using the Viking dice the whole time. But we're at the monster lair. I am retiring the Viking dice.
What?
Not using these today.
I like those
Instead,
dice.
Instead, I'm using Dice Macabre.
Ooh.
This is the new release from Q Workshop. These are dice which are entirely made of skulls.
Okay.
That's just
That's good
hundreds
to know.
And hundreds of skulls. So
I suspect that Dice, I suspect that
Dice
reflects
Macabre from Q Workshop.
I suspect that reflects and, the carpet we're going to find in the monster's lair, doesn't it?
Oh, you never give the GM ideas. You know that by now. Anyway, I have these come uninked, but I just found with a CD writer, and I was able to ink them so that you will read your doom. Hang on, let's get that Viking dice out of here.
No.
So, Edgar, as he said he could, true to his word, and I do love in role-playing games when the dice knows what the story wants. Mm. So, yeah, he is shimmying down that like a gull himself, but Saywin is absolutely staring at Elfnoff, who you know did not climb up and down that cliff. He just couldn't. The man is not physically capable of doing that. But yet he went down to that boat and put the treasures in there.
Hmm. Well, now, that is interesting. Elfnoff, I hope you're not making this harder than it has to be.
Sorry? Now, you can make an investigation check.
Sure. Bald Eadig is still not that bright after 9 sessions. 5.
Okay, no worries.
Seems to me that if you were using that boat down there to store your ill-gotten gains, you'd probably be interested in finding another way down, straight down the cliff.
I climbed.
You climbed,
did
you?
I did you now, said Saywin. Why don't you give us a demonstration?
By all means, after us. We want to keep a close eye on you. Eddie, Elfnoff's coming down now. Watch he doesn't fall.
Elfnoff, don't! You'll fall. You trip over the pot. You'll trip over everything. Don't follow. You'll hurt yourself.
Good advice from Edie. If only there was another way down.
Yes, I climbed down that path. And he points over to where there's kind of two rocks on the headland. And you didn't see the detail, but now that he's pointing at it and you're looking for it, you absolutely can see just the beginning of a trail going down there.
Oh, good. Yeah. Right, after you.
Oh no! I would be a liability. I'm sure. After you. That sounded like an intimidation. But with advantage, because this man is not possessive of a spine, like the corpse of Nut the Old, no longer possessing of a spine.
Too soon. All right, and because Bald Eadig has an imposing presence, I can use strength instead of charisma when I'm trying to be intimidating. So that is what I'll do, and I will roll a 21.
He shaking. He is heading down there. This is not a very Christian act. This is not a very charitable act. But there is no man or woman of your followers who is against it.
That's all right. He doesn't have many friends at all.
So you walk down the path, Eddie beats you.
No like, surprise.
Down he goes, and you see, even in the hood of his cassock, he's just tucked a couple of gull's eggs for later. you know, just waste not, want not. You are down on the beach, the stinking beach, and let me just treat us to some more fine. Fine. Oh, there's let me treat you for right now. I forgot the portrait of Eddie. So there is Edgar, very keen to prove himself this day. And now you are down upon the stinking beach. This slime upon the rocks. It's not so much slime as a kind of brackish water where it is gathered there from the tide, which has gone out. But there are bones, gleaming bones in among there, and scrapes upon the, there's weeds everywhere. It is quite slippery. And on that desolate beach, there is the coracle, broken. It has been smashed.
We need to turn that boat upside down looking for the amulet.
Okay.
Someone post a watch on the cave, make sure nothing sneaks up behind us.
Who are you going to set to do that?
I believe Eastmond is a good choice for the job because he's big and strong and imposing and he tends to do what he's told.
Okay. Is he the follower? You've got a follower that knows no fear, haven't you?
Oh, do I? Do I just...
I thought you had a fearless follower.
That would be great. Maybe not one of the ones I chose, because you did give me a fine list of 8 followers to pick from.
Yes,
which was excellent.
No playthrough of the Hero Sanctuary is the same, and also the heroes are very different as well. I thought one of them was...
Thormund is unfazed. He automatically succeeds on any checks forced by a monster.
Right, yeah. All right. That's because he's here to kill it. I hate to tell you, Eadig, but if he gets his chance, bang, he's in.
That's fine. I'll let him have the chance. Thormund, go watch the monster cave.
Yeah, I'll watch it die. And he hoiks up his bestie and goes there. Now, malcontent. Oh, no, you got rid of the malcontent because you gave him a silver ring.
That's true.
He's no longer malcontented, which also means he doesn't rampage in there to kill it. He stays out here. But you know that you will hear from him if anything happens. All right, you are searching the wreckage of the boat. And it is not a difficult search because all the contents are scattered there. And you will find a leather burlap sack. Hang on, you can know it's one or the other. It's leather or burlap, so it's a leather sack. It's waterproof and it's tied up tight, and it is heavy and clanking.
I open it.
All right, and there, gleaming gold and silver, all the treasures of the sanctuary. There are candle holders. There's an image of God. As in a crucifix, of course, and also older things, all there are spread out upon the sack. And in particular, and that image should be up now, an ornate medallion, a cross, not the Christ cross, older than that, intertwined with serpents. Perfectly round. You've seen it on the ruins. You've seen it on the standing stones. You've seen it in the hand of the cow-robed figure who held it, and the light from it made the monster shrink away.
Fantastic. All right, I'll hold it aloft to everyone so everyone can see it and be inspired by it and say, if those who came before us on this island knew what they knew to be true, then this amulet will deliver us. Surely the Almighty has led us to it, and he has allowed us to find it on this boat, and so it shall keep us safe from this spawn of Cain.
There's a kind of a grinding sound, and it's Eastman having a thought. Right? It's his first one, but he's looking at this, and he is a follower of the book. And he says, but this is a heathen thing, and we know that God guides us. If we put our trust in such a thing, and then his thought has run out.
He's okay.
Just in a state of confusion.
It's a strong point, Eastman. But I believe that God has delivered us to this item, which was wrought by the hands of man. Perhaps not as the old ones believed in the old ways, brought by their pagan gods. But if this was indeed wrought by the hands of man to drive back the beast, then I'd put my faith in it.
Why I put my faith in you? Cheer up, says Saywin, slap him on the back. You're probably about to see a miracle. All right. Elfnoff says, there's the treasure. See you in the hall.
No, you're staying here.
I'll stay on the beach.
Or you can come in with us, see what all the fuss is about.
No.
I'm a little bit concerned that if I let you wander around, you might jump on our boat, sail out of here before anyone can catch you.
That, of course, Thormund and Leofgut just burst out laughing. I can't possibly sail that. There's only one. It's too cruel. It is not godly. I beg you. And he falls to his knees. He does not want to go to that dark cave where the devil lives.
Well, that's fair enough.
He is now genuinely and terrified.
All right. Well, then maybe he's learned his lesson. Elfnoff, stand up. You've committed grave crimes against us and against your family here on this island. Those that you're sworn to protect. the Hermit and his followers? Do you want to make amends?
I do, and I believe that I have had, but in there I will do more harm than good, Eadig. I hope that this is what you needed, and I'm truly sorry, and I hope that God and you and Egbert will forgive me.
I'd forgive you if you can push yourself to the very bounds of your courage. At the very least, you can stand watch at the cave.
I can do that, yes, yes. If anything comes, I will yell, yes. Believe me, I will yell.
Yes. And if any injured come out, you'll render assistance?
Of course, yes, yes indeed. Yes, yes, I will do that.
And you'll make sure those at the sanctuary know what happens here.
And how long should I wait?
Long as it takes.
Okay then, till the late afternoon. God save you, Eadig!
All right, good man.
I'd just like to apologize to everybody in the trading profession for that display. You yep. don't deal honestly, you just don't get the next deal. It's pretty obvious.
Thank you, Seawin.
All right, Eadig, let's stab this thing.
I roll to stab the monster. Does it work like that?
And after you, she says to Thorman, because as I told you, she never turns her back to him again.
Yikes.
But Thorman is happy to wade right on in.
All right, we will proceed with caution.
It is a dark cave. Let's get your minis racked up here. As I, of course, have to go over there to see what the camera is doing. You have still inspiration in the hand, by the way.
I do.
Here are all your followers. So it's pitch black in there. You can't see a thing. So tell me how you're proceeding and all of that stuff.
All right.
Just got them all there, and you tell me what they're doing, and we'll line them up.
There they are. I believe, as a hero, I am inclined to lead the charge.
Okay.
I imagine...
pretty much in the job statement.
That, exactly right. This amulet, I'd like to have it prominently displayed somehow. I don't know if I can affix it to my front or... excuse me, embed it in my club somehow. There must be some kind of neat trick I can do with it.
This one neat trick. Ah!
Monsters hate him.
You, absolutely. You tell me.
Can I get it on a string or a chain?
No, it has no... I'm looking at the art again. It is solid.
Mm.
Thank you, John Hodgson. It is in the standing stone... it was absolutely held.
Right.
And I shall use this. I should have myself a nice prop here. It's fabulous Devon root compass. So it was this kind of, you know, this kind of action.
Gotcha. Yeah, actually, cool.
It's bigger than that, but yeah.
All right, excellent. In that case, I will just hold it aloft.
That means that you will not be able to swing your club.
With two hands,
while holding it aloft.
That's true. I haven't thought this out all the way. I will hold it aloft for now.
Okay,
wait till a better idea comes to me.
Well, I would say one is kind of looking at you and going, do you want a hand there, mate?
No.
You've got five followers here.
I want to make sure. In with you. I want to make sure this thing is one of the first things the monster sees.
All right. But if you want to pass it to me.
Pass it off if need be. Thank you, Seawin.
All right. So, who's next?
I think how
are you lighting the way?
I imagine we've got torches. I won't have a torch because that's not a heroic thing to do. Heroes don't bear torches. I've got Thormund, I think, up next, is chomping at the bit, ready to go.
Yep.
He doesn't strike me as a torch bearer either. So I guess we'll put Leafgid in the middle, and being in the middle, that's a good place to have a torch.
Okay. All right. Well, yeah, he's certainly, you've asked him to carry that, and so he will do. So he opts to keep his shield up and the torch in the other hand.
Excellent. Cool.
Okay.
And then we'll go Seowyn up next, and Eastman is the brick wall, bringing up the rear.
And Eddie?
Oh, I forgot all about him. He bet stay.
He's actually bought his lucky bucket.
Outstanding.
So, there you go.
So yeah, glad. He better stay up with me and Thormund. I think so we can keep him safe as best we can.
All right, so you've got one torch with Leafgood. Any more?
Is that enough? If he holds it aloft, does that give me enough light to see by?
If you all stay in this exact group, there'll be a lot of shadows bouncing around, but
we'll give...
generally in the Dark Ages, when you go out in the dark, from my extensive research of watching the 13th Warrior, everybody's got a goddamn torch.
We'll give Eddie a torch as well, so that he can kind of dart around as we need it.
Yep, he feels pretty excited about that. All right.
Does he have a weapon? Okay. I haven't looked at his stat block recently.
I think he has a knife.
Fantastic. But of course he is meek, so he doesn't get into a fight.
Yeah, it's
easily
not quite his thing.
Great.
Well, he can engage.
He can engage, yeah.
Yeah.
But he can't be attacked, which is good.
Yeah, and he can rescue as well. So, no, actually, what I'm selling him short. This is the moment he's going to be a man or an adult. So he's totally bought a spear, you know, and it rattles a little bit in his hand. But, you know, he's here for that, which makes his feat of cliff climbing even more impressive. All right. Okay.
All right, we will proceed slowly and cautiously.
All right, down into the dark, dank cave. And there once again is the image of the cave mouth. Into the cavern where it is dark and dank, and immediately the smell is terrible. The cleansing air of the ocean soon drops away. It is dank, and there is definitely a feeling of spoiled meat, an ancient air in here. And as you step in, you feel that force. You feel the evil. You feel the very breath of the devil coming from here. And of course, you're bald Eadig, so you go on in. And definitely Thormund, because he doesn't want to kind of, you know, back down in front of the boss. He steps in. You see Eddie. Well, you probably don't see it, but Eddie really hesitates. And you know that he would never have come in this cave by himself. But with you, he is entering. And along comes Leafgood. Seowyn has lit herself an extra torch because she is no fool. And if something horrible goes wrong, she doesn't want to be left in the dark. And Eastman coming up behind. And it is clear to you that Alfnoff would not have been physically capable of stepping over this threshold. He simply couldn't have done it.
Because he's no follower.
That is exactly right. All right, you can hear a slow dripping in the distance. And as you are all rustling as you move, some clanking, those sounds seem very loud, and the sound of your breathing also feels very, very loud.
So what are we looking at so far? It's just a tunnel straight in?
It is just a tunnel straight in. And it's a tunnel through a cave, which means it is not you know, 10 foot by 10 foot, nicely paved with a little arch. It is, you know, it dips and it curves, and sometimes you must kind of bow your heads a little bit, and sometimes it opens up above you. And you have to watch your feet so you don't kind of trip over the rocks. It is, you know, it's a cave. It has not been fashioned. There are points where you simply cannot see what is ahead because there is a curve, and it's never a squeeze. Although in the tightest place there is a gleam there, and there's a kind of a nasty slimy residue and a really rusted axe.
Head.
Yeah, just the head. Yeah, rusted axe head. As though somebody dropped that while squeezing past.
I'm also keeping an eye on the ceiling and the walls, because the map we found on the standing stone seemed to imply that it leads up to the ruins, I think? Or am I misremembering that?
It was below the ruins.
Right.
And because the standing stone was not drawn to scale, and once you've chosen your stone, you're a little bit limited, so you don't know what depth. But it did have the feeling that the monster slept,
of course,
between four pillars.
Right. But the map didn't show any, well, the map, such as it was, didn't show any branching paths or anything to worry about.
It was not a map.
Okay.
It was a Neolithic carving. I'm just going to throw Neolithic in there, like I know what time period that was. It was an ancient carving of... you've seen the art style. It's just pictograms.
All right. Fair enough.
So there it is. And ahead of you, you go on and on for many paces. Not so much twisting, but going down and occasionally kind of going from side to side. You can feel the hot breath of Formand, and he is definitely kind of, you know, he's the man without fear. So no, he's quite okay. But the others, there's definitely you. There's the light is jittering a little bit in Eddie's hand. Leofgood is stout and true. As you all go deeper and deeper and deeper, and it's like the earth itself is groaning. It's like the cave itself is groaning as you go down into the bowels of the earth. And finally, ahead, you can see some distant feeling of space as it opens out into a chamber. A huge chamber, 100 feet across. You can see shadows in there. Your torchlight is just reaching what seems to be a stalactite. Stalagmite? No, it is a pillar carved with walls, absolutely kind of decorated with knots and interlaced serpents. That pillar is holding up the roof, like you can, it goes all the way up. And then beyond that, you can now just see there are standing stones, like you have seen everywhere on the island. Pillars holding up the roof, and then closer in, standing stones. And as you're moving forward, you can make perception roll for me.
I would love to do that at this stage. Fairly perceptive, I think. 17, yes.
All right. You can see with those standing stones that there is a chain linked of strong metal in ages past. and that that chain is wrapped around the standing stone, and you can see the links of the chain leading into the center of a circle, and it seems to be a decorated pattern of serpents carved upon the stone, and that has the feeling of the decoration of the amulet that you are carrying. Around you, you can see the walls too are carved, and you can see there is a procession of figures and leading someone carrying that serpent cross.
Fantastic.
So
we're following the directions. We're doing what it says in the tin.
Perfect. As you are... now, of course, all your followers are moving into the cave and holding up the light. So, and there's still kind of seaweed slime slick in here. And if you could make another perception roll.
I will at that 11 this time.
Okay. All right. So within that... that circle is a very kind of dark area as it seems to slope down in there. And as you're moving forward with your lights, you can't quite see in, but you get you can now see the glint and gleam of bones in between the standing stones there. And it is high time, I think, that we showed the people at home a visualization of what this all looks like. Alrighty. All of the, in the distance now, I've moved slightly away from the microphone, but all the maps in the Hermit Sanctuary are available in the download as full-sized PDFs to battle map scale. So here it is.
I think I should be concerned if the battle map's coming out. Oh my, there it is. I see.
Now, we had a... Jackson gave me the tremendous tech assistance revelation that you can use the other phone camera in Zoom, which has made our visual fidelity much stronger this week. I hope you've all taken note. It does mean I'm just going to adjust this a little to... get it a bit more centered up. Here is our Beowulf compass, of course.
Fantastic.
And north is heading this way. All right. And so that is...
There we are. Should I be
this
concerned?
This is where you have come in. All right. And as your followers kind of spread out, there's Thormund, who has subtly stepped up right next to you because that's how he rolls. Leif get aware that he's the main torchbearer. He's come in there. Eddie coming around. Saywin holding up a torch directly behind you. And true to her word, she is there to grab that serpent's cross if you need assistance with it.
Good to
okay.
know.
Okay. Now, I believe our torchlight goes just it's the center of this is still in gloom but here are these massive carved stone pillars that hold up the roof and these are the standing stones and these are the chains that you can see within that standing stone.
I suspect that we're right below the ruins as we stand here as well. All right. Obviously, whoever made this place knew more than we do right now. Let's see what we can learn. I'd like to cautiously go to inspect the chains.
Cautiously sounds like stealth.
I guess it might be.
Just to, you know, remind ourselves we're playing a game here and not just making make-believe, so roll that up.
Yeah, I wonder if I am... stealthy. I don't think I have any heavy armor to worry about. Let me have a look.
No, you've seen your photo. In fact, it's on screen a lot of the time. you're just wearing a jerkin.
Excellent. I have a weapon shirt, whatever that is.
So, okay.
That's fine.
That's like an anti-stabbing vest.
Fantastic. So I have tried to be stealthy. Plus one is 11 again.
Just I'm going to roll this d20
for no reason.
No reason at all. And I'm going to add plus two to it. 18. As all the levels go red, Jackson can't hear for a week, but I've been looking forward to that. Sorry, everyone at home. I'm a very irresponsible streamer. Jesus Christ, I think I've got myself as well. All right. I'm all embarrassed now. But anyway, I can't take that back.
The effect was worth it, I think.
All right. Well, when we hear from their lawyers, yeah, there is this huge scream, and the scream is accompanied by a fetid blast, because the thing doing the roaring has the worst breath, because they've been cracking the bones of Nut the Old all night, and old blood, foulness and malevolence, in fact balefulness, as rising from the center, having heard your not so stealthy approach, clearly a bit of a light sleeper. Okay, on the Jamboard, let's just a lovely visualization by John of what that scene looks like. You can see how the kind of the pillars are connected there, and the standing stones, and there's the circle, and rising within that is this creature. There it is, rising up, this bloated figure, rising and rising and still rising to double your height, as its kind of little evil eyes, its massive tusks, how on earth does it close its mouth, as it's shrieking at you, its lank hair like seaweed hanging down, and as it's rising, you can see it has been stabbed many times has this thing been stabbed, and it does not care. So we'd like to welcome to the Thunderdome, here he is, your friend and mine, Mufbona the monster.
Oh, there he is.
So one of the fantastic miniatures as part of Beowulf. So, and if we turn him around, we can see I had so much fun painting all of the times I tried to get him and failed.
Oh my goodness.
So he is rising up, and I have two words to say to you, Bald Eadig. And the first one is roll, and the second one is initiative.
Yeah, you might have caught me by surprise here as I try to find my initiative, and I probably should have rolled some hit dice after the last battle. I hope you don't mind if I go ahead and take that. I think, well, I took a long rest, right?
You took a long rest. You're
yeah,
fine.
Fantastic.
Okay.
That's good to know. All right, so I rolled 9. I think my initiative is only plus 1, so 10.
Alrighty.
How about my followers? Do they get initiative roll of their own, or are they all with me?
Yes, they do. They have a separate roll because you activate them on their initiative.
Mm-hmm. And they've just got plus 0, I imagine. Oh my goodness, they rolled a 20.
Wow, that's good, because Mufbona got a 21.
Oh!
Because it's not about you anymore, Bald Eadig. It's all about Mufbona. He's the people that... he's the one they've come to see. And Mufbona. I'm just going to just practice the pronunciation to like come up with the most hideous version. So, he is rising. And... as he's heard you, and so his first action is just, well, he's standing from prone, taking half his move as he rises up, and then he takes a step here as he comes thundering towards you, and then he kind of pauses. He just holds there for a moment, as you are kind of, you know, thinking, right, here it is, and your followers are like gasping, and you can hear that very Beowulf-y sound, the knuckles tightening on spears. He has to make a saving throw.
Really?
Wisdom saving throw, and he's failed it. So he gets in there, and you can see that there are these chains. They are broken. The chains are, and they look, even though they're old chains, they are freshly broken. You can see where the ends of the chains and the links are. Mm. You know, there is some kind of metal gleaming in there. But he does not leave that stone circle. Instead, he roars at you. And now that he realizes he wants to leave and he can't leave, or he's in a state of huge confusion, which just leads to more roaring. I'm not going to do that again because that hurt too much. But if you want to simulate the pain of his roaring, just punch yourself in the ear. That's what it sounds like.
I was going to say, I've had a great time turning up the reverb effect whenever you give a roar. So folks at home enjoying some lovely cave ambience. So please continue roaring if you've got it in you. And it's...
All right, so he is absolutely... I think I heard that reverb. That was quite disturbing. Yes, so there he is. But he does not come at you just yet.
All right.
Well, that is a complete waste of 21 initiative, McBona. You're dead to me. That's what he's doing.
All right. So I guess my followers activate at this time.
Yes, indeed.
All right. I will murmur to them. Spread out. Oh my goodness. That's more reverb than I was expecting.
I just thought of something you can do. So he realizes he doesn't want to go, but he's so angry, he just reaches up behind his shoulder, pulls a sword out of his back. There's a kind of a some kind of sick spray, and he just whacks it at you. Walkata, 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 bang, crack. So here's one he prepared earlier. What is your armor class?
It's not bad. 13.
All right, 13. Okay. Ka-donk. He's aiming at Thormund. Do you want to kind of get in the way of that or let Thormund cop it?
Because Thormund can take it.
Thormund, I think, is holding the line. Is that correct? No, it's Leifgird.
No, Leifgird. Yes. Leifgird and Eddie have a light.
Right, so he's aiming at Leifgird because he hasn't sussed out who's the hero here yet. All right, so you want to get in the way of that or let Leifgird cop it?
That's all right. Leifgird can take it.
All right. Walkin' a walkin' a walkin' a bang. Then he... I'll just roll the hit, and I rolled 14 plus 7 is 21.
Oh, my.
Death saving throw for Leifgird.
That's not good. He's hardened.
All right.
He's hardened. He gets advantage on death saving throws.
He sees that coming, brings up his shield. He
rolls a 15 twice.
All right, and bang! He's just going through shields like nobody's business. Like the sword smashes, it sticks right through it. Funk, the point comes to Leifgird's kind of, you know, forehead there. And he goes, ah! So that was close. All right, that is Mutborna's turn. All right, now we are back to you.
Excellent. All right, so...
For the people at home, there's a very clear top-down map of the cave. All right.
Let's see if I can show that off. There it is.
Alrighty.
All right, I'll murmur to my followers, spread out. That's still too much reverb, but I don't mind it.
it's gonna get old, Jackson.
All right. I reckon it came out of those chains. Let's see if we can get it back in. I'm encouraging them to circle the monster, circle the chains, and see if we can do anything with them.
All right. So if you think of these as kind of areas, kind of sectors, and I'll just pop the view back to the painting. Basically, they can move position kind of once. So they can go from the cave mouth to the pillar, and then from like pillar to pillar or pillar to standing stone or so on. So you've got your pillar here and your pillar here. I'd say left and right, but I'd all get horribly confused because everything's mirror image to me. So this pillar, who do you want running this way?
Let's just go in order. Eastmund.
Okay, all right. So Eastmund belts down here, yep.
It's followed by Saywin.
Okay. Saywin kind of wants to stay with you. She will take the order if she wants, because she wants to get that cross.
All right, well, that's fair enough. Yeah, good call. Let's go Leifgird then next instead.
Okay, Leafgood, having ruined yet another shield, he's just throwing all the spars and things down, and he's going, Danes don't know how to build shields, as he's throwing it down. All right, dead.
And the other side will have Thormund and Eddie.
Okay, all right, and there goes Eddie. Oh, I was sending him with Thormund. That's a terrible role model. What have you done, Eadig?
I just thought they'd have good chemistry. I just want to see Thormund's, you know, hard heart be softened by a protege.
Or Eadig to grow up to be a psycho. Let's see how that goes. all right. So they run that way. What are you doing?
So once my followers have acted, I'm up next on initiative 10. I'm just going to stride forward, holding the amulet aloft, and trying to get the beast's attention.
Alrighty. You can indeed stride forwards. Now 2, 4, 6, that's just out of attack range. But I think your action is kind of brandishing it, yeah?
Yeah, brandishing it, getting its attention, maybe like getting it to not focus on the fact that it's about to be surrounded by my followers, and just seeing what reaction it has to this amulet.
All right. So now you're walking down into the cave. It's a bit higher here, so you're going down into the hollow as you kind of step off that. But you're a hero, so we're not going to make you faceplant. That would just be embarrassing. So you stride forwards. You're holding up the serpent's cross. As you are coming forwards, it's beating its head like it's being stung by wasps. It's kind of trying to get out of this stone circle. But as you come forwards holding up the serpent's cross, then it absolutely roars at you as it sees that thing. And it's, you see its whole body language as it shrinks away from it. As it does not like that. So that is what occurs there. Okay.
All right. I think while I've got my great club holstered as well, since it's a two-hander, I'll have, if I may, the amulet in one hand and a handy spear in the other. Because I always have a spear.
There's no such thing as a holster for a great club.
No?
It's a tree trunk. You don't just, I'll just tuck that on my belt.
All right. So I'll just drag it along then.
Yeah. There you go. Fred Flintstone style. That's the way to roll. Yeah, Flintstones reference. Boy, I'm down with the kids. Woohoo! Yes, sir. It's like Adventure Time, but with cave people. All right, you are getting down there, and it does not wish for that.
All right, have a move then.
Okay, has a move. So you're coming in that way. Ding, 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 ding. All right, so it retreats.
Really?
From the Serpent's Cross. Alex, let's have a bit of a roll here. Okay. Yes, it is breaking out of the circle.
Oh no!
Rolls 16 on its saving throw. Therein is the skull dice. All right, breaks out of the circle and roars over to here. All right. And it's going to see if it can recharge its power and throw another weapon out of its back. Okay, and I've rolled a 3, so it has not recharged that. And the little buggers run almost off camera over there. So, but that is where it is. As it's kind of like shielding its eyes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it just gets far enough to get out of that circle and then kind of stops there and just kind of roars at you.
All right. There are 4 chains in front of me, right?
Yes, you can look down and see those. You can see that they have huge kind of, they've all been kind of smashed. The monster has broken out of them.
Mm.
So the links are all, so this is an excellent, excellent notion. You could rechain the monster, but you're going to have to forge links.
Right. And there's no smithy nearby in this dank, dark monster cave.
But, you know, maybe you could just wrap the thing up, but that could work if you want to give that a try. The scenario is very clear. It says there is no right way to defeat the monster. There is the way that the hero chooses. I'm not saying that's going to work, but I have been empowered by Mr. John Hodgson to allow you to
excellent.
Do it as you will. Now, for the people at home, thank you, people at home. This is going to be a long episode because I think it just started happening, and this is too much of a cliffhanger, even by my standards. Are you right with that, Jackson?
All good. Let's beat a monster. All right, so for my followers move, I would direct all four of my adult followers to take up a chain from the circle.
Alrighty. Okay. They are going to be heading in that direction from here. Yeah. That's Thorman can reach here. Saywin can reach here, Eastman can reach here, but Leofgood is going to be on his way to the back. Oh, sorry, I've just chosen the movements. Do you want to do that in a different way?
No, however you can get them. No, however you can get them closest enough to the chains, that's fine with me.
Oh, the difficulty is the chain at the back.
I can see that. Yeah,
yeah. The longest run.
Send someone on the way to that, and I'll stay in front of them on my turn. To kind of keep the monster's attention.
All right, now look, this is a little bit of a puzzle.
You want me to solve it?
I want you to optimize it, right? Okay, so you can kind of see where they are.
Yep.
There's a pillar here, there's a stone here, there's a stone here, there's a stone here, there's a pillar here. You got a stone at the back. That stone at the back is two moves away.
Yeah, right? I see what you mean.
So, and if this move, you go this way, well, there's somebody in town.
I see it. All right. So let's have Leaf Geared go to the chain on the left. And that's Eastman next to him to the chain at the back, the center back one from my perspective.
Yep. Okay. Is that correct?
Yep. And then Thormund on the other side one, the one on the right.
Yep.
And I'm going to keep Saywin with me. She's going to go for the you know, the front one or the back one, I guess. Yep.
We're running over there.
We're striding toward the monster.
You're just going through the guts.
Yeah. So the monster is focusing on me because I'm in front, and Saywin is behind me, and Saywin's about to dart for the chain when we get to the middle of the circle. Can we get to the middle of the circle?
Yes, you absolutely can. You can even go further than that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, yeah. Well, a little bit of getting around the stone.
Perfect.
And also, as you are now smashing down, you've gone into that, holding the amulet in this ancient place, and you knock something with your foot as you step in. The skull and spine of Nut the Old. And of all the others who have slain here, but Nut's still kind of freshly gnawed. So, it's pretty horrible in there. And that takes some courage. You can make a saving throw for Saywin.
I sure can. Saywin rolls a 16. She knows what she's signed up for.
Sharp. All right. Nope. She is hard ass in training and in the monster battle. So, she does know what you signed up for. You are running forward. Now, are you still using your action to hold the cross up?
Or I'm still holding them up. Oh, and if I can send Eddie to stalk in the shadows such a way that he can... somewhere near the edges, even like behind Thorman and the edges of the room. I don't know if he can get that far, but yeah, I just want him in the wings, in the shadows.
I just run him off camera, but trust me.
That's fine.
He's there. I like having the camera closer, could kind of sense of the battle, but of course we lose some fidelity.
Hmm.
But I can just open up that cave map again if you... there's Mutborna. All right, so there's the full cave map. So, yes, he's run over to that bottom corner. Does that, of course, you can't hide holding a torch. Now, he has bought his trusty bucket. I don't know why he bought a bucket. It's just that, well, this fine WizKids miniature has a bucket. So that's canon now. It's full of seawater. He can pop the torch straight in there and put it out.
Perfect. I want him in the shadows.
Okay, he has disappeared into the dark. All right, you have gone forwards. That's your followers' move. That's your move. The next round begins. It is the monster's turn. Monster must move away from you.
Really?
But, yes, as you come forward the serpent's cross, he does not like it. So he is retreating because you're brandishing it as your action. So he retreats, but this is his moment to break out, and he runs pounding at Lofgood, who's lost his Danish shield. Out come the claws. He's just gonna grab his head and pull the spine up attached, like just shuck him. So he might want to make a death saving throw with advantage.
He will. I've just turned on the angry monster soundscape in Sirenscape. He'll roll an 18, so he's all good.
All right, it is pretty horrible. Mutbona leans down with this massive claw, and the only thing Lefka does is he treats him like a boar. Bit of a throwback to the very first episode. He puts his foot on his spear, plants his spear on the ground, and literally just pins Mutbona in place. Right, and you see the spear go into this kind of massive, flabby flesh of the monster. Does nothing to it, all right? But it does more or less hold him. So, but it's like stabbing down, but his arm is not quite as long as the spear. So that's kind of Lefgood like going, I can't hold much longer. And you can hear the kind of groaning, and then the snap as the spear flies into splinters, pedaling Lefgood backwards. But he made his death saving throw with advantage, so he does not die this day, but let's see about next round. Okay, your followers, what are they doing?
All right, let me see. So I think Sewin can now gather up the chain that is in front of us.
So she's running through the circle to the back.
Yep.
Okay, yep, I'm with you.
And everyone is just picking up their chain, with the exception of Leafgill, I guess, who is otherwise...
No, he's you can command him to act. The monster is near him, and that's terrifying, but he saved his life. It snapped his spear. Literally the force of the spear snap knocked him back a few paces. He can run around the other side of that standing stone, and he's going, "For not!" as he's like rattling up the chain.
Fantastic. That's terribly heroic. All right, yes, everyone gather up your chains.
Yeah, take notes, Foreman.
We mean to bind it once more.
We need to wrap this up. Okay, everybody has rushed forward and grabbed chains. What are you going to do?
I am going to, if I can, run around the back of him and try to drive him back toward the middle of the circle where he might be bound. I don't know if I can get there with one move.
You can do that. But you're going to have to suffer an attack of opportunity because you have to use your action to show him your cross, as the old joke goes. you have to use an action to do that. And it's simply 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You want to get up behind him, you're just going to have to duck under and he'll have a go.
I can take it.
All right. You run to him.
Feels like a heroic thing to do.
Yeah, it is now the exact, from the standing stone, the hero holding up the serpent's cross, the monster shrinking away from it, but in the style of the Chapel Brothers' infamous incident in Australian sporting history, he does the underarm, scoops up with the underarm claw and tries to disembowel you as you go past. Oh my goodness. So what is your armor class?
Still 13, sir.
13. All right. I'm getting out 2d6 because, as they say, that's how he rolls. I'm going to roll this d20 and I'm going to add 7 to it. All right. Bang. And he rolls a 1! Oh my god! That is terrible. So he goes I'm just running my liquid over there rather than you. He goes to scoop at you and he reaches down and literally looks at you in this kind of leer, and then he sees the serpent cross. And I'm going to change it all up. It's like he's just, he literally, you drive him into the circle as
he
planned. His attack of opportunity has gone so poorly with his roll of 1. That it's turned into a bit of a kind of a move as a triggered action. He screams, and runs away from that thing. He is now in the center of the circle with all of your friends. Speaking of which, what's Eddie up to? We've got him.
Oh, that's a great question. I'm still happy to keep him in the shadows until I need him.
So currently he's off camera in this direction.
I have a mind to pass him the amulet, but I probably can't do it from this great distance. So maybe I'll
he can start belting back towards
you. Yeah, I think I'll try to catch his eye and gesture him over here to take the amulet from me.
Alright, okay, cool. So looking into the camera, so he's about the center, so he gets to about there.
No trouble.
So he's off directly behind Saywin now as he's running laps around the cave. Alright. Sprinting along in the dark. Oh my god. Now, I said that you wouldn't faceplant, but he might. So give him a saving throw with advantage because he's a nimble-footed little hero in making.
Lucky 13, he is nimble enough.
Oh, lucky 13. Okay, he definitely loses his footing and does this kind of, windmill, but it ends out for him. A little bit of slide, and he's on the way, sprinting around. Okay, so that was the monster's turn. That was your turn, okay? And we were just catching up to what Igor. So the new turn starts.
Yep.
There is the monster. There is you with the amulet. You've kind of driven him in there. Everybody's holding there with his chains. But he is absolutely within distance to lash out. He does not go for Lofgood this time. Because Lofgood is, first of all, hard as, and even Mutbona, who is, no fool. I mean, he's huge and ugly and terrifying and violent, but he's no fool. So he's not going to go for that guy again. He's going to go for someone else. I want you to choose, Jackson.
I have to choose?
Which of your followers do you love the least?
Oh, my goodness.
Because he's going to leap at someone. Is it Eastmund, the good-hearted follower of the book, who will never amount to a great hero, but he'll always be there to do what's done? Is it Saywin, the woman who is trying to trade her way to a comfortable future, and this is a phase she has to go through? Or is it Thormund, the man who thinks he'll be a hero? Will his life be cut short, or will he realize his potential? Who does Mutbona attack?
I think it has to be Thormund, but not through the monster's choice. I think Thormund is actually seeing this as a moment to step up and steal just a slice of glory.
That changes everything. So the monster is in this kind of moment. He's absolutely got where you want, and Thormund wrecks the plan. Thormund goads it and says, "A hero is here! It is I, Thormund!" And Thormund's kind of stepping up, and the monster just turns around. Now, you have...
I've got a good bit of inspiration.
Yeah, I know. You've got some... Here we have Baleful Griefs, and we have Ancient Winds. Are you going to throw Thormund a follower inspiration for this death saving throw he's about to make?
Yeah,
or
I think
are you
I...
going to...
I think I need him alive. So, he better have it.
Okay, so...
Unless he's already got it for some reason. I think he might.
He does not.
No, he's not hardened. Someone else was hardened.
Lofgood is hardened. Thormund is not afraid.
Mm.
He's the man with no fear.
He's unfazed.
He's unfazed, and he's no longer malcontented. He is very content. He's going to stab this thing in the brain, or so he thinks. Or he's going to get his spinal column ripped out. Mate, so are you spending your follower advantage?
I would care to do just that, yes.
So there was a portent, and the portent was
Ancient Winds.
So you got to grab Ancient or grab Winds. You got to tell me why the portent said that Thormund would stand against the monster and not get his spine shocked out.
because he is like the wind. He is suddenly very supple and bendy, and swift and nimble. So even though he puts up the big hard wall, he's actually jumping back and forth to grab the monster's attention, but duck and weave out of his attacks.
Bearskin flying! It's his moment has arrived. He is goading the monster. Make his saving throw with advantage. If we remove this inspiration token, that one's gone. How did he go?
It could have been an 8, but instead it was a 14.
Hey! All right. And there even seems to be some wind stirs in the cave. Some sea breeze down here as Thormund, who nearly wrecked the whole plan, manages to survive that attack. All right. That is all I got. All right.
Fantastic.
So, yeah. Your follower's turn.
All right. Eddie is going to make a sprint for me to grab the amulet off me. Okay. But I'm about to run into the monster.
That's so okay, because your follower's got initiative... No, your follower's got initiative 20 and you got initiative 11.
Yeah.
So Eddie's actually here before...
Fantastic. Okay. I pass him the amulet and say, keep it safe.
And he runs forwards, in that moment, he absolutely, you're reminded of Eddie in the forest and that first time you fought the boar. Eddie, who looked up to you and who followed you from that day and became a warrior, became Leofgud.
What a twist.
What a twist. And there was a day when you were both covered in the gore of sea raiders, and he said, "Don't call me Eddie again." All right, so this is Eddie 2, the ending. He runs forward. Are you giving him the cross as the pass?
Yeah, I'll pass it to him.
All right, okay. He's nimble, and he's not going to flub that. He can get a gull's egg while climbing down a cliff. There's no way he's got fumble fingers.
Fantastic.
Eastman, roll the dice. All right, Eddie grabs it.
And to everyone else, take up your chains and wrap it.
Grabs it.
He grabs it. Oh, that's it. All right. Take up your chains. Try to bind it.
You've got me curious now. I think it's not quite. It is similar style.
Oh, this is of course our inspiration coins.
Yes, indeed. Oh, it is the very image.
Oh, my goodness.
God, I've had the prop in my hand the whole time. What a reveal. That is the Serpent's Cross.
There you go.
Wow, because John Hodgson's a smarter fellow than I am. So, thus he blows. Eddie grabs it. And he will do as you wish him to. You're ordering everybody to grab up the chains.
Yep.
And to wrap it.
And I'm imagining them like... doing some kind of maypole action. Everyone grabs the chains and starts running clockwise, getting closer and closer into the monster.
All right, you don't want to run Widdershins. That's like a Wicker Man situation. All right, clockwise it is. I'm just going to have to go clockwise from where I'm looking at them if the camera's reversed. I'm sorry about that. All right, so grab the chain and run. So to there, to there, to there, and to there, as they run around dragging the cables, as Mutbona is screaming, as the chains start to wrap around. They're going to have to go four times around him for a good
lap. Oh my goodness, all right.
Yeah, absolutely. This is a fantastic solution. So I'm sure John Hodgson is high-fiving you, except it's not 3 a.m. In the UK, Scotland, or wherever he is, over there, Northern Hemisphere. Bang! They are doing the action that you wanted, but the monster is by no means chained, and Eddie is back here, which means the Serpent's Cross is currently static. What are you going to do, bald eating?
I'm going to hero up. I'm going to take my great club in two hands and keep it occupied while the chains are being wrapped.
Alrighty. Okay. You go forwards, charging through, raising your club high, and belt it.
Ooh, lucky 7, which is not great. That brings my attack to 13.
13 is... you have... bang! slender thing, but it is huge, and it has this kind of blubbery kind of armor. Not armor, but it's a soft flesh. You gotta hit the thing and boom. Kind of a ripple of all of this kind of hideous gore-slicked material, and it does nothing at all. And Mutbono kind of goes, you can imagine that with a huge tusk. Oh, that's a terrible impression. I look like a bad rabbit. As a hero has run at him with a weapon and struck him, and he has not hurt at all. This has happened many times. It's ancient evil, and all of those weapons are still in his back. He knew you couldn't hurt him, and you haven't. It's the next round. It's his turn. So he is going for it, attacking you this time. All right. And I have inspiration for him when I want it, but I think I'm gonna hold that. All right, okay, here he goes. Whap! 18, that's a hit. Bang, you've run in and gone for him, and he claws at you. You pedal out of the way, but you know, your leather surcoat is kind of ripped, and you catch your breath, having taken no harm, but 9 points of damage.
9 points, alrighty.
And there's that moment where you think, has my arm been torn off? Am I getting a slowly rising view of the cave as my head is pulled gracefully from my neck hole? No.
Not yet.
Then you realize you can't move because you, Bald Eadig, the grappler, have been grappled. I am the grappler and you are the grapplee. Bang! That claw has struck you and grabbed.
Oh, that just seems wrong.
All right, and now he is pulling you into his embrace, and now you're seeing that, yeah, heads are ripped off, but all of the damage, the cracking of the bones come from those terrible tusks. He's just basically just going to push you into his head and rip your face off with an upward tusk action. So that's not good. Follower's turn.
Follower's still maypoling.
All right, follow the clock.
Eddie, maybe get back toward the entrance kind of way, so that if we fall here today, he's first out, and maybe he can use the amulet to slow it down.
Okay, Eddie runs up to there. Eddie is very concerned about what is happening to his hero and yours and mine, Bald Eadig. He probably needs to make a little bit of a saving throw.
He is eager. Yeah, he rolls a 5.
All right, he's eager. I'll give him advantage on that. Have another go.
Oh, very very kind. He rolls a 6.
All right. So
if this was a wisdom check, by the way, he's got disadvantage on that because he is young.
All righty. So you want him to cover the rear and make everything safe. But he's just so so distressed by what's going on here.
That's only fair.
That he comes running forward, and it's Thormund. And you say, Eddie, to the... yell to him what you wanted him to do. Let's hear it.
Eddie, stand by the door.
All right, so he runs... But Eadig! And he's running towards you holding the amulet, and Thormund said, Eadig said by the door, boy! And is gonna like raise his hand and punt him in the right direction. You're gonna let that go on and let Thormund slap him back on track?
Yeah, I have bigger problems to deal with right now.
All right.
Then Eddie getting his sense knocked into him.
Bang! He gets smashed. He tumbles. He starts to wail. He runs off and does as he's told. He got beaten up by his uncle. It's a horrible scene, but he has learned a lesson. and he never turns his back on Thorman for the rest of his life.
All right. Saywin goes, like, she's like dragging her chain around, and she's like, you know, you just like hear her teeth grit. She hates Thorman. It has advanced to malcontent. She cannot stand to follow you if he is following you.
Wow.
Like when he beats a child, strikes the boy, like that's the end of the, I'd say end of the rope, but truly end of the chain. Hmm. So around they go.
Around they go.
And it's all going on. And that is the follower's turn. And now it is your turn and you are grappled.
I am grappled.
This is what the people want to see. This is why they bought the expensive seats.
Yes, indeed.
Hero on monster, Greco-Roman, what happens?
All right. Once again, I've failed to remember the 5e grappling rules because...
Nobody knows grappling rules. Although, weirdly enough, they're quite simple these days.
Can I still attack with disadvantage? Do I have disadvantage?
You do not have disadvantage. That is not a thing. What you cannot do is move.
All right. That's
grapple
all right.
Basically just stops your movement. So you can wail away.
Yep, I will do just that.
I like the little starter rule book when I need to look up something quickly. It's got a nice little form factor. So we see grapple, blah, 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 blah. Your speed is zero. That's it.
Nice. All right.
Speed zero.
Can I try to grapple it?
Of course you can.
Can we grapple each other?
Grapple. That is the way wrestling works.
I think so. I think so.
So I'm gonna make you make an escape attempt first. It's
first,
15.
All right, that'll be an athletics roll, I believe.
Flip it. Yep.
Easy, 25.
All right. So I'm now making up my own grappling rules because everyone does. So you've effectively escaped, and I'll give you now. I'll say that was a bonus action. Now it's like a free. Like you're grappling him.
Yeah.
So this is a comparative athletics check. The good news is about escaping is he can't gore you with those tusks, which is not good.
To attempt to grapple him, I will roll a 20.
He's rolled 19.
Ooh.
And he's adding his strength of 5. Oh. You may have wrestled a pig, farmer boy, but this is Mutbona, ancient evil with huge tusks.
Yeah, but he's got tusks. He's got tusks. He's technically a pig.
He is technically a pig, but next time you grapple him, you might want to consider your ancient grappling art.
Oh, I did think to myself, I will use that this turn. Completely forgot.
Okay, so you break out of his hold. You try to seize him, but he's just too big and too disgusting and all slick and gory, and you just kind of pop off. All right. So he has you where he wants you, but he senses that the chains are coming around him. This is a moment where he kind of knows about the chains, you know, because he's been chained here in the past and he knows it's going to happen again. In his great evil, he wants to rip off your skull and vertebrae and blah, do all that stuff that we've been describing. But he also is utterly evil and just knows all he has to do is kill one person and this whole chain plan is going to fail. So he is going to bounce out of here. He does not go for Saywin because of the strange clockiness. And I think we've had 2 rotations, is that correct?
I believe so, yeah. They've gone around twice. They need to go around twice more.
Yeah, okay, great. So he doesn't go for Saywin because Saywin has the Serpent's Cross. So,
Eadig does. Behind
Serpent's
her.
Cross. Yeah, Serpent's Cross behind her. Mm. So he's had bad luck against Leofgood. Thormund is behind you. So he bursts over here and grabs Eastmund. Just reaches out. Death saving throw time for him.
Eastmund, and he's not hardened, is he?
And this is Baleful! Baleful! The monster is using his other advantage token to give you disadvantage on this saving throw because I am a monster and so is it. So it is grabbing Eastman to stop the chain plan.
Oh my goodness! Could have rolled an 18, but rolls a 13. Lucky 13! He's still standing!
What?! With disadvantage?!
With
no
disadvantage!
Way.
18 and 13,
God.
Sir!
What? 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 If I didn't trust you implicitly, I'd say bullshit, but yes. So it has reached for Eastman, and it is trying to pull his head off, you know? And Eastman just kind of strains his neck muscles and just more or less just holds his head in his body, you know? As he's being kind of...
he's made of stronger stuff.
Lifted up off the ground. But his faith in God. And also, you promised him that the serpent's cross was the was the salvation. And he believed you. And it is completely true. So as he just basically just toughs it out, just holds onto the chain and does not die this day. Well done. Exciting stuff. Whew. That was the monster's attack. So it is your turn.
Excellent. Now, followers, one more run around the maypole.
Okay, there it is. Clonk, 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 clonk. All right, as Eastman runs out of its reach and gets around, the chains are wrapping up.
Eddie stays where he is.
Yep. Okay, he's holding the cross.
And now that we're out of this grappling nonsense, I will take up my great club once more.
And belt it!
And belt him with my, this is my pocket inspiration, one that I might get back.
Oh, okay, great.
Yeah, just to get advantage, just so I actually do some damage for the first time.
Alright, beautiful.
Here we go. Oh my, yep, that comes back to bite me, a one and a two.
Alrighty. Oh no!
That's how you know I'm not lying.
Thank you.
That's
was
all good.
Was your Christian dice the two?
You know it was.
Then at least you get the inspiration back.
Oh, of course. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, you get your inspiration back. Because you always roll two dice and you nominate your old ways dice and your Christian dice. Mm. So even though God does not smite him, you have belted it and you nearly brain yourself. You go whap with the great club and he's like big bouncy back and boom. And like you have to go, oh shit. As the great club comes back in your face.
Good
which I would have had you hit yourself if you would have been on one, but the two has saved you. So God's got your back, or in this case, your nose.
Fantastic.
All right, shebang. But you get its attention with that strike. It turns to you and smites you. It has used its advantage. You have one spare hero advantage token left, plus the one you've got the hopper. So you've got inspiration to burn. Here it goes, whapping you again. That is a clear hit. You are taking another claw strike. For 6 and 5 is 11 points of damage.
Oh my goodness. That brings me down to 5 hit points. One more swing will take me out.
Well, it's worse than that. Because when it claws you, it grabs you. And
again?
That is an auto... that's what it does. That's an auto gore with the tusks. So it has... you've bounced off it. It's turned around and seized you.
All right. I hate to do it. I might get one of my followers to take a blow.
That means you're going to have to choose which follower. Oh, take that blow.
Take that blow.
Take that blow.
When
okay.
I receive damage, I can spend a follower, which means the follower absorbs the damage and must make a death saving throw.
Alrighty, so a little bit of retcon there, but it's okay. We want to show how the rules work. So it you can see the claw coming in, you go, this is bad, and somebody says, I will save Eadig. Who is it?
Where is Eastman right now? No reason.
You're in the center of the circle and they're all running around the
circle. They're all quite close.
It's your choice.
I want it to be... who's that in the left? Because I want to get Eddie to take up the chain. Yeah, that
one. This one here?
Yeah, who's that?
That is Eastman.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Absolutely called him.
Yep, so Eastman's going to take it, and if he falls, then Eddie can run in and take the chain up.
Well, he's going to be spent. Like,
that's true,
he's dead or not.
He is spent.
He's going to be out of this fight. So Eastman sees that running in and goes, God save us! And he runs in and gets in the way. You don't take that damage. Eastman gets it. Bang! Once again, he survived last time. Does he survive this time? Make a death save. I think, is that what it says? He takes the damage and makes a death save.
Yeah. He does. He is slain this day with a 2.
And there is the face of Eastman, kind of, you know, with this kind of expression of, you know, God save us. And, you know, he's looking stern and he starts to hold his neck, but bang, there is a shower of gore as his head is pulled up, his spinal column comes up and is kind of great. This is not family friendly anymore. Should have put a warning on that. As bang, he bursts apart, hideously killed. Mufbona is now waving the spinal column and skull around like a chain and roaring with laughter. But you don't take any damage, so that's good.
Yeah, back up to 16 hit points. Which is all right. Which is gonna
put one of our death tokens down here to say where poor Eastman was slain.
All right,
that was awful. So followers' turn.
All right, as they're still running, as they're still moving, I'll call to Eddie to take up his chain.
Alrighty. So, I think the great thing about the way the clock works, and you've worked this out because you know how a puzzle goes, is that the Ofquid runs around to here.
That's what I had in mind. Yeah.
And there's a little bit. I mean, technically the change over there once, but God, we're not gonna quibble over a heroic and also horrific death. As Eastman gives his life for Bald Eadig and God. Whop.
Was that the last go around? Was that number 4? I lost count.
That is. They have now got him all wrapped up. But he's not going to take this quietly. But as the chains are all pulled taut, it kind of yanks him into the center. And he kind of, you know, pushes out of the way of you. Now they're now all leaning in, they're straining to tighten, and he is going to break out and kill somebody else. And then you're just not going to have enough people for the job. So you're going to have to wrestle him.
Yep.
To pin him to the spot. This is what it's all been coming to. You've wrestled him once. He's swatted you away. He is the stronger opponent. I like the head crack there. That's,
we can do it. We can do it.
There, Jackson.
Thank you.
All righty. So
Eadig is a head cracker.
All right. I presume you're going to spend...
I would love to.
From the portent... The portent is ancient.
Let's ancient. Use the portent one. Because we're putting him back to his ancient prison once and for all.
Of course you are. All right. It is spent. You are rolling with advantage. All right. He is not, because I spent mine because I'm a fool. All right. But his strength is plus 5. His athletics plus 7. He's a tough boy. He's rolled a 12, gives him 19. What did you get?
A nat 20.
What? Oh my God!
Would you like a snap of this one? I can take a snap of that.
There it is. I trust you implicitly. Just hold the dice up to we know that a dice was rolled, even though.
Well, I won't move the dice tray, but there it is as I change the focus.
Oh, look at that! And
you can't see it because it's too bright. But you know,
that's fantastic, and a nice little product placement of our Campaign Coins dice tray, available at campaigncoins.com. It was the blue dice. It was the god dice.
Yeah, well, actually, that is. Oh no, you can't see it all. It was the god die. There it is.
It is.
Hey.
Oh, look.
And in fact, that was that very die is. Is the first D20 I ever got from the D&D 4th edition starter set way back in 2009. So that's
I
nice.
May weep openly. Shout out to our friend Rob Hines, who did that fantastic edition that we enjoyed very much. And that promise is being kept. You hold the monster as your followers run around, and then now they're reattaching the chains. Mutboner is screaming and yelling. Now that he's chained, it's like the standing stones. And something's happening now which is not Christian, which is old. It's the old ways. Wow. And you can see there are now four shadowy figures. Your followers have somehow turned to this one-eyed man, to this bearded, to this kind of stern woman. And Eadig has become this laughing maniac holding fire, the trickster Loki. And somehow they are at once merged with the stones, and they are speaking in a language long lost to you. But as they intone, Mufbona starts swatting at his head, like there's bees in his head. He's going down and down and down. And are you going to let him go or take the dirt nap with him?
No, I am not inclined to let go at this stage, at this late stage.
Alrighty. So he is, but he's like cracking one eye and kind of looking at you. He might get an escape attempt unless you let the ancient magic do its thing. The ancient magic.
Well, yeah, if letting go is gonna help the chains work, then I will do that instead.
Or will it? Who knows?
I don't know.
What? I've made up my mind. Are you going to stay here, or are you going to say, this is what I wanted?
I'll see what the chains do. I'll let go and take up my great club instead. And
okay,
watch.
Okay, you let go. You've got a bit of a spear handle and an axe blade under your armpit because you've all been kind of commingled with Mutbona as... And he curls up in the center of his den, the chains wrapping around and around him. And suddenly there's just standing stones with a lot of chains and your followers going...
He sleeps once more.
And Foreman is like, it's a pity Eastman was too weak to stand against it.
Thormund, I won't hear you speak ill of him.
You hear all the muscles in Saywin's body tighten. She's going to put her spear through his neck. Let's see how your speech goes. What did you say?
Thormund, you will not speak a word of ill against the fallen hero here today.
Make an intimidate roll.
Oh, 7.
But it's... Well, I'm just saying. Heroes. And Saywin is like, that is it. I leave your service or he does. I was going to wait, but I cannot stand to be with this man without honor. He thinks courage is a badge. It is not. I will not be party to this anymore. And she's down. She's actually cradling Eastman's body. Yeah, we don't need the traitor, says Thormund.
Thormund, you are the one who betrays the honor of this band. By your words and by your actions, I fear that you do not walk the hero's path.
I walk it. I'll see you on the whale road. And he rips the silver ring off his arm and throws it down. And he leaves.
As well he should.
Eadig is like going, you know, as the off-good goes, good riddance. And that
is how the monster Mutbona, which was raised by the cracking of the ancient stones, when the ruin was disturbed, it broke the chains and he came out from sleep. That is how he was put back to sleep by Bald Eadig. Now, Thormund, of course, is going to go off to another part of the island, pitch a tent and wait for the next boat. Maybe he'll have some, you know, chats with a hermit and become a better person. I don't think so. But he is gone. He has left your service. All right. You all emerge. Emerge from the cave. And you go to the sanctuary, I presume.
I would say so.
All right.
As we leave the cave ambiance behind.
There is Alfnoff, who's just like literally rooted to the spot. He wants to be anywhere else but here. But, you know, you intimidated him to stay and he stayed. Okay. So, bearing your fallen friend, the warrior, you walk up the sea path and up to the hall, and there is the half of the hall. As you arrive, not with poor Eastmund and not with Thormund, but something in your countenance, your resolve, that all in there know that they have been saved. So Cairo rushes forward and she embraces Eadig, who just wants to tell the whole tale
Edgar?
Now.
Or embraces Eadig.
No, for sure. Why not? That is Freudian slip. She totally embraces you because you brought the boy back and because she sees from your face the grief upon you, the resolution of the hero. There are no words that can be spoken, but she appreciates. And then she hugs the kid so hard that there's a little rib crack. But hey, he's young and flexible. I'm sure it'll be fine. All right. And there is the hermit, Egbert. And there, of course, is also your elf wolf looking very shamefaced. What has happened?
My friends, though it pains me that we lost a great many good souls on this island and they have gone to their eternal reward, it does bring me joy to say that you are delivered from this beast of Cain today. He sleeps once more beneath the ruins, and he should not be disturbed further.
Then God has sent you, and God has delivered us. I would have you, Bald Eadig, take treasures, because the treasures have been kind of put back on the bench. They've been displayed in the meantime by Saywin. I would have you take treasures from that you have returned, because God thanks you and I thank you, but I would have you rewarded, and it was foolish of me to leave these valuable things here where we do not need them and where they have tempted a man to sin. And he shall atone, and I shall welcome him. We should pray away this crime and remove the temptation.
Sir, your forgiveness inspires all of us to walk the godly path. And all I right. will gratefully accept your gifts. They will bring great honor to my band and to my lord.
All right, so we are going to give some treasure.
Way!
How good is that? Treasure. It's like loot, but treasure. I'm going to need 5d6 here. All right, do you have 5d6?
I sure do. I believe so. I've got 1, 2, 3. Well, I've got 3, so that's almost 6. I can roll them twice.
Okay. All right, so roll roll three.
All right, 3d6 gives me 10.
No, I want the numbers in
sequence. Oh, you want the numbers. From left to right, I've got a 3 and a 2 and a 5.
All right, two more.
Two more d6s. I've got a 4 and then a 1.
4 and a 1. Okay. He gifts you with a hard-woven copper talisman.
Ooh.
Set with glass of great age, handed down through generations.
Very nice.
Mm. All right. Now, I'll roll the two dice. This time you roll the three. To Saywin, he gives...
A 4, a 1, a 3.
Okay, to her, he gives a glittering gold arm ring, enameled in bright colours from a far-flung land.
Very nice.
It is of a design you have never seen before, and she says, "This is from the Kingdom of the Mords. I have long wanted to trade there. I've heard there is a great hero, sails the whale road. This is a gift I will treasure. Not as much as the gift of not having to see Foreman's stupid face again, but hey, it's pretty good." Alrighty. What does he give to Arlie Offgood?
Gives a 6, a 2, a 1.
To Leofgood, he gives a patterned copper flagon. Hey!
Cheers to that.
Which is carved with knots of great age handed down through generations. So again, with the generations, yeah, it's an old cup. But it's what Leofgood, he's actually, ever since you inspired him when he was young Eddie in a catastrophic retcon that I thought of just on the spur of the moment, he has followed you and will. He does not attain to be a hero. He just attains to be part of your deeds and stories, and that is what he wants. So he will drink to that.
Good man.
All right. And I think that's it, because no treasure for Thormund.
No.
And
What about young Eddie? You get anything?
Right. Well, you've asked, so of course.
He held the chains alongside the strongest of us.
Yep, that is only fair.
He gets a nice one, I think. A 6, a 6, and a 3.
Alrighty. He gets a patterned red gold arm ring.
Ooh.
He's gonna have to grow into it. Which is set with garnets. And again, from a far flung land.
Mm.
I give this to you because it has traveled far. What's his actual name? We've called him Eddie so long.
I think it was Edgar, right?
Edgar. Now, Edgar, it is for you to decide if this is symbolic of the travels you will take, or if this gift will calm your heart and know that the travel has come to you and you will stay with us and your mother. That is why I have chosen this gift for you. And Edgar is kind of looking, and he's absolutely caught, you know, and also he's got a bruised rib. So there he is. He's literally standing between Caro, his mother, and between you, Eadig. And he's pinned there holding this precious thing, and he's making his decision. And the decision is going to be made by your body language. You tell me, is it a smile? Is it a slight shake? You know, he's now faced a monster bravely and truly.
Why?
And like Leofgood of old, he has met you with a tusked monster.
Mm.
And he wishes that he will be Leofgood too. You're going to need another one. Leofgood's going to get old. Or it will break his mother's heart, even though she's been prepared. So he looks at her. And she cannot decide, because she knows he wants it and he needs to do this, but she cannot stand it. It may kill her. She looks at you.
Well, I don't know if I can say all this with body language, but... I can't tell him what to do. The first step on the path of being a hero has to be taken by oneself, but if he chooses to take that step, then... there's a space in my boat for him.
Okay. All right, so you look at him. You're an actor. How'd you do that with body language? Oh, that's terrible. You should never have taken that one job you did in a commercial. It has ruined you, sir. You need to do more Shakespeare.
All right, it's an eyebrow waggle and a slight and a slight head tilt back.
All right, so kind of looking out the open door, he rushes to his mother and squeezes her back and says, "I shall return. I will come back, and we will be comfortable and happy. But this is what I've dreamed of." And she says, I know. And once again, she's in a position of rubbing his head, looking at you and weeping. But then she smiles and says, "Well, let us have a feast to send you off." All right. So you have a new follower. But I'm coming too, says Cairo.
Oh my goodness.
So she wants to be your follower. She actually wants to come along.
There's a space to be filled.
All right, the family
it's
is
two
not
spaces
broken
actually
up. And Elfnoff, you're the cook now, so get busy. And you will nourish the hermit, and you will look after him as he has looked after you, and this is how you will repay him. And Elfnoff says, I will. And I have helped you enough, and I think I can do this. So he has a change of heart. Saywin says, we can do that trading now. I only forgot about, in all the drama, Saywin being sick, but I think she forgot it too. So she gives him a very favorable trade. And you have a new follower in Cairo and Edgar, and there is great celebration. Anything else you're doing before you leave the island?
No, only drinking and feasting and celebrating. I would probably speak to the hermit one last time and tell him what I've learned about the monster and what keeps him bound. And maybe even counsel him to seek a new sanctuary.
We will not. Yeah, actually, you have just cleverly roleplayed your way out of my incredible trap by calling upon the wisest person in the room, even though somewhat addled. He says, I believe that the creature was freed when the stones were moved. Frifkar will put them back. He will use different stones, and then it will sleep undisturbed.
That...
Frifkar goes, oh, bugger.
I did tell him. Did tell him to remember where he got him from.
Yeah, right.
I'm glad we found the source of this curse, but I do caution you again. If it seems that the creature is uncontainable once more, I think perhaps you would find more peaceful sanctuary and solitude elsewhere.
This is my home. Here I pray. And when the pilgrim died, I prayed to God. And God delivered you. I need nothing. This is my home. And you have saved me. And you have saved it. Go in peace.
I roll to go in peace.
All right, so let us see this last view of the island. Got the image there of out in back on the whale road with everybody coming to the cliffs to see you off. Saywin has done a truly terrible trade. She's basically just like loaded them up with goods. But there's a song in her heart because there's a lonely tent which blew down in the night, and now Thormund is sick. And he's waiting for the next boat up here. And Saywin will be telling everyone, oh, don't trade there. Pff, waste of time. Oh my God, they've got nothing. While quietly making arrangements to keep the food going. So that is it. Listen. This is the poem where we started. Everything you need to know about this scenario was in the introduction. What? A far-flung isle, mist-mantled, rune-deep. Surrounded by the whale's way, a speck of footfall firmly set upon a bright blue shield, the stone boss boldly sits. Battle-battered by billow maidens, ancient bearer of grave and grove, home of bristle-backed boar racked by wild winds keening, gulls wheeling screech its scops, baleful beaked eagles unlock their word hoard. Bitter brine, not balming beer, is lapped by that weird wrought isle, once a holy held place, a blessing not bane to honest kin. In half of deep-dwelled slaughter, its leavings glut the grey-cloaked wolf, gorges the black raven's bent beak, feast-giver for Woden's greedy birds. Moon-bleached, snow-skinned, shield-breaker, blood-drinker, a pale scabbard for a sword host of battle. Bold warriors, hardened half-troop, wreak their craft, battle-lights sing, but do not sever. Blood embers swing, harmless their hewing, no war sweat stricken from war needles striking. Forge fired, handiwork of smiths have no power present there. Weed unraveled, blades bite dulled, fates weave woe in warp and weft. There was baleful grief here, there was loss, but there was heroism, and the ancient winds have lulled this terrible monster back to sleep. The end.
Outstanding. Well, now, I had a great time. I imagine you did, Mark, and I can only hope that the viewers at home had a great time as well.
Look, I totally did. I think this is a really magical version of D&D, which hits so many bases that it is easy to play. You only have to arrange one player. And I know diaries are hard, but generally we can manage that. With tremendous mechanics to support that. And it's just heroic. It's kind of the story you want D&D to be, not just like I miss.
Absolutely.
It's like all on. So I did. And thank you very much, Jackson, for being perfect bald Eadig. And I thank you for being superb. And everybody else, I have an announcement. There is going to be a season two. But Jackson is bald Eadig, and I could not imagine him as anyone else. So he's going to step behind the desk, and we are going to have a new hero to be announced on a new adventure with a new monster. So thanks, everyone. We really enjoyed it.
Absolutely. Can't wait.
So that'll be mid-April.
Mid-April, yeah. Great. That was BEOWULF Age of Heroes, The Hero Sanctuary, which is a free download right now. We've been listening to the beautiful tunes and soundscapes by Sirenscape, which just came in. That was a random shuffle to this tune, and it made a perfect backdrop for the poem. I don't know if anyone else noticed that, but I was very pleased.
I love it.
And that was that. We are Campaign Coins. That was BEOWULF. We'll see you for season two at some point in the future.
All right. Thanks, everyone.
Bye for now.